Good morning, everybody. Glad to see you here. Welcome to those online. Glad you're joining us. It's a beautiful day and a wonderful day to be at Noelridge Christian Church. I have a few announcements. If you'd look at your folder inside the insert inside your bulletin, that would be a good idea. Baseball tickets should be purchased today. We're going to the game next Sunday afternoon. So get your tickets today so that those can be ordered. We're getting them at a discount for just $10, but you need to let the office or Pastor Gregory know about that today. On the back of the bulletin, under coming up, there is one slight mistake. If you're on congregational life or missions, you know missions is always at 5:30. Congregational life is always at 6:30. There was a typo there. Those got switched. But that has not been a change, just a typo. Let's see. This week on Tuesday night, the NFL ladies are going out for dinner. So if you haven't RSVP'd to Liz Norman, do that so you can enjoy dinner on Tuesday night. And Linda Osmondson still has some pop and water available for purchase for $5 a case. So let her know if you would like some pop or water. Everybody who loves the Lord is invited to join us for communion in our services. Most of us are going to come forward as the deacons guide us to come forward, and then we'll take a piece of bread and a cup with juice and dispose of the cups in the waste can and then return to our seats. You may have already picked up a disposable set of communion. You can use those, or at communion time, you can raise your hand and a deacon will serve you in your seat. Would you please join me in prayer? Dear Lord of life, love, and hope, we praise you and thank you for bringing us together today. May we feel your presence in our hearts as we hear your word. May we feel the joy you bring as we lift our voices to you in song. And may we see reflections of your love for us in the faces of all your children joined here today to worship you. Guide us and help us to understand what you would have us learn. Help us to find and follow your will for our lives. Amen. Now, would all who are able please stand and join in singing our hymn of worship, Your Name.
Actually, we're going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Otherwise, I'd be in trouble because that's not the music sitting in front of me.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, his mercy rings, unending love, amazing grace. Grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious is that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are to me, his word.
Music?
Yes.
Classic music? Rock and roll, anybody? Frozen? Yeah, that's good music. So I like music too, and you know God enjoys it when we make a joyful noise to Him. Do you know that? So when Randy plays or sings for us. So what are some of your favorite songs? I know you said Frozen. Yes?
Ode to Joy.
Ode to Joy? Okay. Yes. Do you have a favorite? Okay. So do you know Jesus Loves Me? Do you know that song?
Oh,
can we just sing like a little bit of it?
That's the best.
Okay. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Okay, that's all you need to sing. Thank you. Now, when do you guys normally sing? Maybe in church, right? Sunday school, vacation Bible school, at night, someone's birthday party, a school program? No? So maybe you sing in the shower? I bet there's people out there that sing in the shower. See? I was going to invite the people that are acting like children to come up too, so... But do you ever sing when you're feeling sad to maybe make you happy? No? What about when something is wrong or you're in trouble? Do you sing then?
Yeah.
You just play dead? Okay, good plan. So normally, when we give thanks and praise to God with our songs, that means something good is happening, right? So Pastor Gregory today is going to share a story about two people in the Bible that were singing in a pretty bad and tough situation. Their names were Paul and Silas. So they actually got arrested for helping someone. So the church leaders did not like what they were doing, and they put them in prison. Now, fortunately, I've never been in jail that we are aware of. But if I was arrested, I would feel pretty low and upset, and I don't think I'd feel like singing, right? You'd feel pretty sad. But guess what? Paul and Silas... what they were doing late night in the prison. What do you think they were doing? They were singing, that's right. So I don't know how cheerful they felt, but they knew that what they were doing was going to be good in God's eyes. So while they were singing and praying, an earthquake hit. And the ground shook so hard it busted the doors of the jail open. Yeah, that's a good thing. Yeah. So what does that story teach us? Does it mean that we should always rejoice and act happy even when we feel sad?
Be happy.
Be happy, yeah.
Be happy that God is a thing.
How is that a good thing? That's a great question. So Pastor will tell us a little bit more about this story, but they were joyful in a bad situation and they were praising God. Oh, that's a really good question. Yeah. You have a good one, Stetson? What's that?
Maybe they were happy when the ground got destroyed.
Maybe, yeah. So we won't always feel happy and we won't always feel like singing, but we can pray no matter what, right? We can always turn to God and we can always pray and ask Him. So God hears our prayers and He grants us those wishes many times, doesn't he? We can have prayers of thanksgiving and prayers of sadness when we don't feel so joyful. So we can rejoice in him and others, right? And we can always sing and make music. So let us pray. Dear God, thank you for opportunities to share your love and spread your good news to others. Help us to be bold in sharing our faith and help us sing and rejoice no matter what. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys.
As we do prepare to go to the Lord our God in a time of prayer, I'd first extend an invitation to you. Why don't you turn to your neighbor and tell them that Jesus loves you. And isn't that such a good thing indeed? Let us go to the Lord our God in a time of prayer. Abiding and everlasting God, we come to you once again on this holy day, and we give thanks to you for the opportunity to be present here in this time and in this space, to be present to one another, our fellow workers in the vineyard of the Lord, and to be present to your Spirit, who enlivens us with energy and enthusiasm, and who speaks love continuously into our hearts and to our souls. This week, Lord, we've journeyed back to this place, back to this time, and along the way, we've encountered challenges and circumstances that have been out of our control. We've encountered opportunities to fellowship with one another, and we've encountered opportunities where we have fallen short. We recognize, God, that we are not perfect, that we are imperfect beings, yet called beautiful and beloved by a perfect God. Allow us, in our shortcomings, in our fallacies, in our faults, to grow ever closer to you in this time of worship. Allow our minds to be opened, our hearts to grow 10 sizes. Allow us to have ears to hear and eyes to see and hands and feet to serve. Allow us, O God, to continue to strive to become who you are calling us to be. And allow us to not let circumstances define our actions, but rather that our actions define our circumstances. Equip us with hearts to serve and grace to give to others through your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so rich and free.
Yeah, every once in a while on a Sunday morning, the Spirit has a way of moving and shaking and stirring things up in a way that we didn't quite anticipate. And so there's going to be a slight amendment to the sermon title today. The Sunday school this morning had a great discussion like they always do. It was lively and energetic. And if you haven't had an opportunity to join them yet, it's a lot of fun, 8:30. It's good time. You want to be there for it. Anyway, so they decided this morning that the new sermon title that Isabel helped come up with is A Faith That Shakes Prison Walls. Okay? So that's our new sermon title this morning. So with that in mind, let us turn to God's holy word and hear from the 16th chapter of Acts. Once when we were going to a place of prayer, we were met by a female slave who had a spirit by which she predicted the future. She earned a great deal of money for her owners by fortune telling. Now, she followed Paul and the rest of us around, shouting, "These men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved." She kept this up for many days. Finally, Paul became so annoyed that he turned around and said to the Spirit, "In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her." At that moment, the Spirit left her. When her owners realized that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to face the authorities. They brought them before the magistrates and said, "These men are Jews and are throwing our entire city into an uproar by advocating customs unlawful for us Romans to practice or accept." The crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he had received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in stocks. Now about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaking. At once, all the prison doors flew open, and everyone's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, "Do not harm yourself. We are all here." The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked, "Sir, what must I do to be saved?" They replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your whole household." Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all others in the house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds, and then immediately he and all of his household were baptized. The jailer brought them into the house, set a meal before them, and he was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole household. May we hear this as a living word this morning. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, our rock and our salvation. You know, it's hard to believe that we're coming to the conclusion of our summer sermon series on the book of Acts. In fact, it's hard to believe that summer's almost over. Here we are, it's, you know, the middle of July, but there's like, what, 5 weeks, 4 weeks of summer left? Pretty soon we're going to be gearing up for back to school activities, fall events, Thanksgiving and Advent are just around the corner. And before we know it, since it's Iowa, the snow's going to fly. Yeah, that's what I've been told anyways. For the past 6 weeks, we've been journeying through the book of Acts together, looking at stories that have challenged us and informed our understanding of what it means to be a church. We've looked at stories like Ananias and Sapphira lying in church and wondered, how does that apply to our life? We looked at stories that have affirmed our sense of what it means to be persons of faith. We looked at stories that we're not sure what to do with, like Peter and the great picnic blanket in the sky. These stories have been part of our formation, part of becoming who we are as a church. And today we continue on reading in Acts, and we come to this story about Paul and Silas. And I think there's a Kenny Rogers song or something like that out there about this. I thought about singing it and looking it up, but I decided not to. So, blessings today, right? Yeah, we read this story today, and on some levels, it's pretty straightforward. It's pretty standard for the book of Acts, or at least what we've seen so far. God's servants are arrested. God provides deliverance through a divine act of nature, a miracle of nature. The servants then use the opportunity to evangelize and to witness, and a lost soul and a lost household come to know the true triune God. Pretty straightforward, at least on the surface. And yet, as so often is the case, when we dive a little deeper into our understanding of Scripture, our understanding of the way in which the Bible is a living and active Word of God that still speaks to us today, we see a reality, a passage of Scripture that is a reflection of the world in which we live, offers us a holistic picture. We see in this passage that there are human trafficking issues. Slavery is present here. There are financial ramifications and cost of living issues, job loss, and oppression. There's an unjust court system. Takes advantage of marginalized individuals on the outskirts of societies. There is a beating and torture of individuals, not because of their actions, but because of the color of their skin. There is racism at the hands of the authorities. There's improper jailing here. Attempted suicide was found in this passage. We also see the healing and caring for of the marginalized and the oppressed. The liberation of the other, the least of these. We hear that question, what is the value of life really worth? Sure, it's a pretty straightforward reading of the passage. And yet, as a people of faith, we get to wrestle with this tension. We have the opportunity to wrestle with it, to look at these passages that inform our understanding of who we are and who God is. And we get to ask the question, what do we need to take away from this story as individuals and as a church? To live into a reality in which God is calling us into. And sometimes we do get to choose and we get to cherry pick a little bit, right? I mean, personally, if I was going to choose today, the thing that I would take away and stick in my back pocket to pull out later, I really like the line about Paul got so annoyed that he turned around and did something. Going to use that later when I need to take the trash out, right? That's the line I would take away, right? Oh, if Paul gets annoyed, I can too. And yet, when we reflect theologically on the injustices that are carried out in this passage that are so present, it almost seems like we're reading the news, right? And the echoes behind the word, we hear words of lament, as found in Lamentations. The joy of our hearts has ceased. Our dancing has been turned to mourning. The crown has fallen off our head. Woe to us, for we, your people, have sinned. For our heart has become sick. For these things our eyes have grown dim. For Mount Zion lies desolate, and the jackals prowl over it. We hear these words. These words spoken thousands of years ago and yet so painfully relevant to us today. We encounter this passage and we recognize the complicity of the church in allowing these things to continue to take place, these injustices to happen, human trafficking and racism and sexism and beating of the poor and marginalized. And we wonder if all these things taking place, why is our ministry no longer effective? Why are we not having the impact in the world that we desire? Why are we not becoming who God is calling us to be? We don't know. And so we come to this place on a Sunday morning. And maybe we get filled up for a minute or for an hour, maybe even a day. But then as the week goes on, as the news cycle fills up on our phones and on the televisions, as we see these tragedies taking place before our very eyes, we see that the joy in our heart, the joy of faith, has ceased. And instead of dancing, we mourn and complain and lament and say life isn't fair. And there's nothing that I can do to help them. If we were honest, we were being truthful, we would say to ourselves, I've allowed the jackals who are at the door to come in and sit on the couch and make a place in our home and in our hearts. Question then becomes, where do we begin? Where do we begin to change this broken system, this world in which we live that is so unjust and so unfair? When we're complicit in it, what do we do to become the church that God is calling us to be? How are we responsible for these things? How do we change our course of action? Do we begin by systematically addressing the injustices in our actions, our thoughts, and our deeds? Yes, absolutely. But I think even more than that, we have to begin with the recognition that when Jesus came and said, I come to give sight to the blind, make the lame walk, give hearing to the deaf, and set the captive free, Jesus said he was going to do that, not the church. We are complicit. But our primary charge is not to address all these issues. It's not today. It's not tomorrow. It hasn't ever been. One of the greatest challenges when we look back at the historic church over the course of the last 2,000 years is the church has a tendency to try to be everything to everyone at every time. Okay? The church wants to be the Walmart for people's lives. So the church wants to, give you tires and dish soap and toothpaste and dog food and fishing equipment and all those different things. Be a one-stop shop for the people's capacity to live. And just like Walmart, over the course of 1,000 years, the church has done all of these things. Churches have clothing ministries and feeding ministries and daycares and preschools and community gardens and homeless ministries and bingo nights and wedding ministries and funeral ministries and choirs that go around and sing in nursing homes and outreach, and the list goes on and on and on. And then churches have food banks and food closets and food stores, and all of a sudden, over time, gradually, we look up and the church says, why are we here? What are we doing? Because we're doing all these different things and none of it's working. What is our purpose? What is our mission? What is our reason for existing and being here? Because for the longest time, it seems like we've run around and done a little bit of everything, and nothing really has worked to meet every need of all the people we meet in this life. And maybe somewhere in the back of our minds, there's a recognition. A little light bulb goes off. That maybe in trying to do everything, we aren't doing anything. We aren't really meeting anyone's needs. Yes, we have a broad range of ministries, but didn't Jesus tell a parable about what happens with seed when it's scattered and thrown on the ground? When the church gets too spread out, it's like that seed that falls among the rocks. It sprouts and it grows quickly, and it seems like there's promise and hope there. But because it doesn't have roots, it's burned up and it fades away. Like ministries are often like that. When the seed has fallen on rocky soil, when one person leaves or dies or gets burned out from trying to make the thing work, and the ministry dies too. And you're looking around and you realize that all these different ministries that the church has been doing, while well-intended, are really just seeds that are waiting to be burned up and at the end of their lifespan. And then we have the audacity to wonder and to lament and say, God, you've taken our joy away. Our dancing has turned to mourning. Our eyes are dim. And our heart is sick. And we wonder where God is. Yeah, I think sometimes when we ask where God is looking at us and saying, where are you? So what's the answer? What is the solution to the problem? Is it throwing out more seed? Hoping that maybe some takes for once? Or do you charter a different path? Go to a different field and cultivate and nurture and care for it and bring it up in a way where the seed has an opportunity to flourish. Instead of going shallow, do you go deep? In our passage today, we see the answer. Believe it or not, it's tucked in there too. See a different alternative for the church. One that has a ministry and a mission and a purpose, and that it has been the same ministry and mission and purpose for 2,000 years. That has sustained its journey even throughout the most difficult of circumstances. Bishop Ken Utner penned these words a few years ago. He said, we cannot do everything. And there is a sense of liberation in realizing that. This enables us to do something and to do it very, very well. It may be incomplete, but it is a beginning, a step along the way, an opportunity for the Lord's grace to enter and do the rest. We may never see the end results, but that is the difference between the master builder and the worker. We are the workers, not the master builder. We are ministers, not messiahs. We are prophets of a future that's not our own. As Paul and Silas sat in the stockades in that prison cell, they could have been worried about a number of different things, from their own physical well-being to the inhumane conditions that got them there, to the way in which they were dragged through the streets and mocked and beaten and spit upon. They could have written letters to congressmen and senators all day. But they didn't. They were concerned with one thing: spiritual well-being of others. That was their only focus. We see that as they sat there in their stockades, uncomfortably, maybe with blood still dripping out of their wounds, about midnight, they prayed. And they were singing hymns, and the other prisoners were listening. Why is that? I think the answer's pretty clear. Because they wanted to be a part of a faith that was bigger than themselves. So the first and primary charge of the church has always been to bear witness, to testify and to speak to the goodness of God in all circumstances in life, instead of mourning, to practice proclamation. To be like King David, who writes in the 71st Psalm, "As for me, I will hope continually and will praise you more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteous acts, the deeds of your salvation all the day long, for their number, although past my knowledge, I will testify to the mighty deeds of God, and I will remind others of your righteousness alone." That is the charge of the church above all things, to proclaim and to testify to the power of God to change lives through Jesus Christ. And with the help of the Holy Spirit, begin to break down the walls of sin and the walls of shame that separate man from the heart of God. What would it look like if a church would go deep? To say our one job, our one focus, above all things, above everything else that we do, is to deepen our relationship with Jesus Christ and to help others on their journey too. It might just look like the kind of faith that is so deep and so grounded in its calling that God has set before it, that it shakes loose the walls of the prison and the chains that hold us back from who God is calling us to be. It's the kind of faith that changes the world. In actions and words and in deeds, it's the kind of faith that has changed the world. Just ask a prison guard who, in his lowest point of his life, when it was about to end, asked the witnesses, "What must I do to be saved?" And their answer was simple and deep. They said, "Believe in Jesus Christ and you will be saved." What a faith that is. A faith that shakes prison walls and compels us to be witnesses here on this earth. Amen.
Will you join with me as we sing our communion song in this very room?
Enough joy for one like me, and there's quite this very room, there's quite enough.
It is recorded in God's holy word that on the night Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread, and after giving thanks for it, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, and said, "Take and eat, for this is my body that has been broken for you." And likewise, after supper, Jesus took a cup, and after giving thanks for it, he blessed it and gave it to them, and said, "Take and drink, for this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, that has been poured out for one and for all. So often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Let us pray. Holy God, you created us in love and created us to love. Because of your love for us, you sent Jesus Christ that we may learn to love you, to love ourselves, and to love one another. In taking this bread and this cup, we remember the Christ you sent. Help us learn here Christ's way of love and compassion. By your Spirit and in Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we continue to prepare, let us confess our faith. I believe in Jesus as the Christ, the Son of the living God, and I seek to follow him as my Lord and Savior. Every week, we have a stewardship moment right here in our service and talk about the many ways that we can serve the kingdom of God and in his church. Today, I want to point out something that all of you here are already doing. You are being here. Just your presence here is a joy and an encouragement for all of the rest of us. If you have shared a smile or a kind word with someone else this morning, that's even better. If you're taking care of a responsibility today, thank you. If it's a morning that you didn't have a particular reason that you were supposed to be at church, but you're here anyway, thank you. Maybe it's a morning when you're glad you didn't have any responsibilities because it was all you could do just to get here. Thank you for choosing to come. Your presence is a gift to all of us and a gift to God. And for those of you watching online, you have also given the gift of your time to God. And you've probably experienced or been told the many benefits that you would receive from being part of a church and worshiping in person with them. But maybe you haven't considered what a gift it would be for your presence to be here with us, a gift to us. Encouraging fellow Christians by meeting with them and worshiping with them is an offering. And while we're glad that you've chosen to be here with us online, we hope that we will have the privilege of getting to meet you in person and having you be here with us soon. We will now receive this morning's financial offerings. Bless these gifts and all of the other gifts that we offer in your service. Bless those who give and may their efforts increase the glory of your kingdom. Amen.
If there's anyone here that's new to the community, yet to establish a church home, or you feel that God is calling you to become part of this family of faith here at Noelridge Christian Church, we would invite you to do so as we continue to stand and sing our closing hymn. To sign up to attend the baseball game here in 2 weeks, next week. Catherine will have the clipboard out back after church, so just so you're aware of that. We receive now this benediction. Thus has said the Lord God from on high, I have loved you with an everlasting love. With loving kindness I have drawn you unto me, and I will continue to set your hearts on fire with my amazing love. Amen.